I finally found some time to experiment with Dina Wakely's paint, stencils, and rubber stamps. Today I'm going to show you some fun techniques and ways to use them. Let's begin with three of Dina's stencils. I have affirmations, tracks, and plastic canvas. Sort of three different variations on the stencil theme. I have a really tiny design, something large and open, and I have some fairly fine letters. I'm going to ghost with these, and then I'm going to use some sprays through them. I want to create a really nice background that I can do whatever with. So I'm going to start with tracks, because it's the biggest, chunkiest design here. Let's see. I think I'm going to put some clear water through here. I'm going to put some water up here. Let's see. Maybe I'll keep the tracks all going in the same direction. And then I think I will print this right here. So I'll get that negative image. And I have to be patient now, which is not my strong suit, but I do have to be patient to let the water do its magic, as it were. It's going to take a couple of seconds here for the lifting to happen. Now you can see it starting here. You can see the color beginning to lighten. Waiting for this is always the hardest thing for me because it's really exciting. You want to see what's going to happen. But if you rush it, then you really get very little happening. So I think we've probably got enough time passed here. Yep, we're definitely seeing some lifting going on here. How cool is this design? It's very tribal, very chunky, very earthy and organic. I think this is really, really nice. I'm going to come in now and I'm just going to blot this corner because this is the one I did second. You can see I've got some lifting going on here, and then this will be the negative image where I turned the stencil over and I printed the water that was on it. So again, I have some really nice patterning going on here in the background, which is always something I'm looking for. Now I'm going to bring in plastic canvas, and for this, this is waterfall green. This is the De La Rowney F&W Pearlescent Ink. I put it in an empty bottle with some water, I mixed it up, and you can see that the pigment settles on the bottom, so you really do have to shake it. And I would be remiss if I didn't remind you that once you're through spraying, you should always, first of all, put the caps back on in between. These are fairly airtight and will stop that clogging that happens in here. But when you're through spraying for a session, take this out of the bottle, put it in a cup of clear water, and spritz until you have clear water coming out of that nozzle. That way you will not get clogs, hopefully. I mean, it does happen some of the time. I can't promise you that it won't, but hopefully it won't. All right, so this is pretty light, but you can just see that it's going on there. I'm going to come through with, let's see where it is. This is Stream, so I'm going to add some of this over here. And then I'm going to turn this over and print this down here. So I've got some nice patterning going on. Oh, how cool is that? That really stands out against that pink. That looks really nice. So before I can do the next thing, I really need to dry. So bear with me 1 second while I bring in my tool and I dry this, and then I'll come back and I'm going to spray this with black so these words are going to jump right off the page. I don't ordinarily use a lot of black in my work, but I think for this it's going to look really good if I do. So I'm going to turn the stencil so it's oriented with the text toward me. And I'm just going to bring in a couple of scratch pieces of paper. I don't want the overspray to land where I don't want it to be. Ordinarily, I don't worry too much about overspray, but in the case of black, I think it's definitely a problem if it happens, and so I'm just going to sort of protect the areas around the stencil. I'm probably not even going to spray this far down, but I'm covered in case I decide to. So there's that. And how cool is that? You get these words that just come off because there's such strong contrast, they just jump right off the page. I think I'm going to come and do a little bit more here. Again, I'm going to kind of block this so that I don't get overspray where I don't want it. And rather than spray at the top because I'm unmasked up there, I'm just going to slide this down and I'll do it here. So now I have this really cool page going. I could bring in my Pitt pens, I could outline and create a border around this spread, lots of different ways to use this. But the nice thing is with these stencils, you have really great options in terms of patterning and texture. Earlier this year when I attended Winter CHA, I was fortunate enough to be invited to an event that Ranger held early one morning on the show floor, where they had each of the four signature designers, Tim and Diane, Wendy, and of course Dina, they had them set up at stations with their new products, and it was a really nice experience to be able to walk around, see the products in action, get to spend some time talking to the person who developed and who uses them. And so one of the things that Dina demoed is what she calls reduction stenciling, and I want to show you that now. This all starts with gesso. In order for this technique to work, you have to prime your page with gesso. Now, for the sake of argument, I'm just going to show you what she does here on this tag. I want you to be able to see what this looks like, and if I do this on a white page, it's just not going to show up. Now, of course, Dina will always tell you she lives in Arizona, and so things dry really quickly there. But basically, you're just kind of looking for a quick coat of gesso. It doesn't have to be thick, and of course, the thicker you put it on, the longer it's going to take to dry. So this is about what you're looking for. I'm just going to put this to one side now and get it out of the way. Clean up the gesso off the table, and now I'm going to bring in the journal that I'm working on. Now, I will tell you that I'm working on... This is one of the Strathmore Art Journals. This is the mixed media version, so the pages are smooth. But someplace here, I have a sample that I did on watercolor paper that I'm going to show you, that you will see that this technique works the same way. It's just you're going to see a little bit more texture because the surface of the paper tends to be more textured, unless, of course, you're using hot press paper. But what I'm using is cold press, and even though I'm saying it does provide some texture, I don't want you to think that that's a down. In fact, it's not. It provides some really cool texture for a different look. So let me just bring this side of this page spread in. This is something that I've been working on, and you can see these hearts are white against a colored background. And that's where the gesso and the reduction stenciling comes in. So I'm going to bring in some of Dina's paints, and I have had just a little bit of an opportunity to play with these. So I'm going to start with turquoise, and I'm going to start with magenta, and then I'm going to bring in a little bit of blackberry. So the first thing I want to do is go ahead and I want to get some of the turquoise on this page. These are Dina's brushes. This is a 1-inch. These are really interesting. The bristles are far stiffer than you would find in a traditional brush, so they work really well to spread that paint. Now again, she will tell you, if you listen to her and you're fortunate enough to take a class or to hear her demo, she will tell you that she uses really light layers. So that's almost dry brushing, and that's pretty much what I'm going for here. I don't know what that black is, but we'll work around it. And if I think I've got a little bit too much paint there, I can just take some off. I have a rag off to the side here. I can just take a little bit off, but this is fine. All right, so now I'm going to bring in this stencil is from Dina's set that's called The Basics, and it's obviously a stencil mask combination. You can see the stencil openings here, and then I have the corresponding mask. So what I'm going to do is, because this is still damp, you can't let the paint dry. If you do, then this technique isn't going to work. I'm going to take, you can either use a baby wipe or, you know, a rag that you have that's dampened with water. And I'm going to come in, and here's where the magic of the gesso happens. It allows you to actually lift this color off, again, before it's dry, revealing, now you could pull this all off till you get all white, or you can leave a little bit here like I have. But it's important that you do this while the paint is still damp. Now you can see where my application of gesso was uneven. Again, I always shoot for imperfection because it's far easier to achieve, and quite honestly, it provides a lot of nice texture there. So now I'm just going to bring in my third heart, and I'm going to lift the color off. And basically what I'm doing is I'm mimicking what's on the other side of this spread. I'm going to put them together, and you can see that it's kind of opposites, so that they become each side becomes part of a larger whole. Now, the one thing that I didn't do was bring in a little bit of this magenta, so I think I'm going to do that now, and I'm just going to lightly spread it in various places. I just want to get a little pink in here, and if I come back and I go over, I should have done this first, but if I go over my hearts, it's a simple enough matter, and if you do it and you forget to do it like I just did, it's really a simple matter to just come in and kind of clean that off, because I want that pink to be more in the background. So I'm just going to do this. Now what I want to do, you can see that I've got some, well, let me slide this back over. You can see that I've got some darker pink in here. That's the blackberry violet color. These are heavy body acrylics, which means that they have some body to them. If you put a bead out, the bead is actually going to hold its shape. This isn't like Tim's Distress paints, which tend to be more fluid, or it's obviously not like any of the sprays, which are very water-based and liquid. These are quite different. So what I'm going to do is make sure I have this going the correct way, so that I, because this is one of the things that I am just slightly anal about, I will confess to that. All I'm going to do is just kind of scooch some of this blackberry violet on here. Again, I'm looking for uneven, and I'm just going to press this on here. I'm going to print a little bit of color kind of in the shape of the heart. I like that. I think it looks really cool. The texture, the gesso on the page kind of adds to that. And I can print a little bit here, and if I don't think I've got enough, I can just kind of smear it over that side of the heart. And then I can just go ahead and press that on there. Now I want to dry this a little bit. Even though it's a very thin coat of paint, it's the Northeast here. I'm in Rhode Island, as you probably all know, and that means that it tends to be definitely more humid than it would be in Arizona, and it's rainy today. So I need to just take a moment and dry this off. Something that I should have said but I didn't is because I'm using Dina's products, I'm very much working in her style, which is very organic, very loose, very open. And so that's why you see this look, and it's very much an imitation of Dina's style, and I felt that that was appropriate, again, because I'm using her products. So I just want to talk about this magenta for one second. If I think that this background is looking a little bit too planned and organized, I can come back and just throw a little bit of this color here and there. And if I don't like the way it looks, I can come and I can brush some of it out. Again, you have to do this while it's wet, but I can kind of modify things. So, you know, you can always take a step back if you need to and add a little bit. So with this done, what I want to do now is I want to bring in, this is the plastic canvas stencil. So I want to bring in some of this, and I want to just add a little texture and background shimmer. So again, I have the waterfall pearlescent ink. I'm just going to give the bottle a shake. And I'm going to lightly spray through here, just along the top, and then I think I will just go ahead and print this a little bit along the bottom. And once again, I am going to have to take a moment to dry this so that I can go on to the next thing. All right, that's pretty much close enough, because what I want to do next, actually, before I spend any more time drying, is I want to put these drips in. You can see here I've done that. So all I'm going to do is kind of face this toward you. I'm going to hold the bottle right up against the top of the page, and I'm going to spray, and then I'm going to let gravity do its thing. And I'm just going to let those drips happen down the page. So what I'm going to do now is come back, and I'm going to finish drying. I'll dry what I just sprayed with for the drips, and I'll dry what I sprayed through the stencil, and then we'll be ready for the next step. With the drips and what I sprayed through the stencil dry, what I want to do next is add a little bit of background imagery. This is the scribble from, this is Dina's texture stamp set, and this is here, all her scribbly words. All I'm going to do, this is Ranger's Aquamarine Archival Ink. I don't want to stamp this directly on, I want to just brush it across, and that's going to give me some really light imagery. I don't want these to jump off the page, I just want them to be a little bit in the background. And if I think that I want to, where is that heart? Gotta be here someplace. Oh, there it is. Sorry about that. If I think that I want to stamp around the heart, but I don't want to stamp in the heart, what I can do is just go ahead and mask this off using the mask, and that way it will look like the text is behind the heart, which again is always kind of fun. So again, I'm just going to swipe, and that gives me, well, that was upside down, but I won't tell anybody if you don't. That gives me sort of that text business. All I want to do is add a little bit of texture, and I like the way that that looks. So before I go any further, what I want to do is let me bring in this piece. This is a piece of 140-pound watercolor paper, and you can see that there's quite a bit of difference here in as much as you really see the texture of the paper on here. But what I wanted to show you is that even though this is a mixed-media journal and the pages tend to be smoother, you certainly can do this in your watercolor journals or on any watercolor paper. Just a little bit different. You might not clean as much off of the hearts, but it works really well, and it's certainly very doable. So now I'm going to bring in, this is a Posterman. This is the 2mm paint pen, and this is one that actually has a chisel tip. If I turn it, you can see it. So what I'm going to do is use the point. I don't want a really broad stroke, but I want to, let me bring this back in, I want to outline the hearts, again, in this very sketchy, loose style. So all I'm going to do is just kind of come in here and do this. If I think it needs a little bit more in any particular place, I can just come and I can add it, and then I can just kind of put some dots and a few little sketchy pieces around just to kind of add some more texture. So I do need to take a second to dry this. Again, it's humid today, and I don't want to smear this because I really like this spread. Okay, we're dry enough now that I feel safe coming in and working without thinking that I'm going to smear this. So this is, let's see, this is from Dina's Scribbly Woman set, and it's got these three really wonderful images on it, and it's got some text. Now on this side, I've chosen to use this person right here, this head, and I've actually added some shoulders and dropped her down just so that she fills up a little bit more of the page. For this side, I'm going to use this image. So I've got Black Stays On, it's here, I'm going to use it, I'm going to ink up this stamp, and I'm going to try to make her just a smidge taller if I can. We'll just have to see how that looks. So I want to stamp her maybe just up here like this a little bit. And there she is. So now I'm going to bring the Posterman pen back in, and I'm just going to extend the lines of her dress here, so that she becomes a little bit of a fuller figure. If you want to come back and you want to imitate some of what's on here, you can certainly do that, and I would go ahead and I would fill this in the rest of the way down. I could take some of the text and stamp it on here if I want. I could scratch some borders around here, which I might do because I kind of like that look. I could come in and I could write a sentiment on here if I wanted to. But you can see the reduction stenciling is really effective. And when you put gesso on the page first, in combination with Dina's paints or really with any paints, but when you put gesso on the page first, you get an entirely different look and feel. Everything behaves a little bit differently, which allows you some real creative opportunities. Dina's initial release of stamps through Ranger is 6 unmounted sets. I have 4 of them here, and in addition to that, there are 2 others. There is these collage hearts, really nice elements that you can stamp and color and cut out and use as collage elements. And then there's this called All the Gals. This is the 6 that are in these 2 sets, just smaller versions for you. And then there's all of these great words that you can stamp as well. I'm actually going to work with the girls, both of these sets, and the birds. You saw me use the textured background stamps when I did that page spread just a moment ago, and I'm going to bring that back in 1 second. These are great textures, great background stamps. You can do lots of different things with them. When you decide that you're going to use the women and the birds, you have a couple of different options. So let me drag back in that journal that I was working on a short time ago. So here's what I did after I got through filming. I came back and I played around a little bit more, but you can see this is one of those stamps from the texture stamp. It's the scribbling. Here's my women. You can leave them black and white. They're very effective that way. But if you decide you want to color them, I'm going to show you how to do that. Same thing with the birds. If you want to leave them black and white or just black against your background, that works perfectly well too. Nothing says that you have to color them. But if you want to, oh boy, can that be fun. If you watched the April-May version of the Creativity Calendar, my Creativity Calendar journal rather, you saw this page and you saw me work with the scribbly birds. They are wonderful, and I think that they're really fun when they're colored in. Now I went a little glittery and added some glitter to each of these. It's easy enough to do with some stickles if you want, or you can just leave them without. For our purposes now, I'm going to show you how I color them. So let's start with the birds. I have all of the different styles stamped here, and this is what I work with. These are Tim's Detail Water Brushes that I fill with dilutions and color wash. Typically, they're my diluted version of the colors. I don't generally use them full strength. I have a couple that I do, but for the most part, they're those lighter versions. So these are birds. These can be fantasy birds. They don't have to be genuine bird colors. I'm not going to call the bird police on you if you use a different color system. So I like, when I'm working especially with these brushes, it's easy to get strokes and scribbly looks. So I try to emulate that, this look that Dina started here, I try to emulate that when I go ahead and I add color. So it really is as simple as this. It won't help if I squeezed this so I had some color flowing out. You know what, that's a little bit close. Let's bring in, this is after midnight. Do this instead. Now I'm going to stroke upward from the tail because I just want to imitate that look of the of feathers. Again, kind of scribbly. If I want to use this as my base color, I can. And then I could bring something in. I like purple and turquoise together, so I can bring in some stream, and I can kind of do that. Now, one of the things that I've seen Dina do, and she does it quite frequently, is she likes to put little hearts on her birds. Now, the one thing that I will tell you is, if you're coloring a specific area and you don't want the colors to bleed together, you need to make certain that it's dry before you go ahead and you add anything else on, because like anything wet, it's going to wick color to it. So, for example, if I wanted to come in, and again, this is something that she does, and I wanted to put just a little heart on the breast of this bird, that's dry enough now. I'm going to bring in, this is again my Posterman, this is the 2mm medium tip, and I'm just going to put a little tiny heart there. Now I am going to have to dry this because it's paint, it's going to take a second, but if I want to come back and fill that in with something a little bit pink, I can certainly do that. Bam, done, easy. And I like to, let's see, let's use a little bit of orange. This is Postbox Red, close enough, it's orangey enough for me. I like to just go ahead and do the feet. I'm going to cut these out, so if I go far outside the lines, it really doesn't make any difference. And you're just going to do the same thing. You're going to continue on as you work with all of these bird stamps. Like I said, they can be any color you want. This is Chopped Pesto, which is a really good color. Again, it works well with the, let's bring in some London Blue. This will be nice. But you see how effective this is, and it kind of continues that scribbly look that she started, and I think that this makes really pretty little birds. Bam, you're done. Get some stickles if you want. You don't have to if you don't. And if you want to color them in a little bit blockier, this is less scribbly than this is because I've overlapped the strokes of color a little bit more. You can certainly do that too. So the girls, all in all their various forms. Let's just bring them in here for 1 second. This is Scribbly Women. And this is Faces in the Crowd. And I've got both sets stamped out, and I've actually got one already started that I want to show you. Again, you can make these bright, you can do whatever you want with them. That's the joy of this. Take what Dean has given you to start with and then just go with it. So I've got one going here. Again, I used, and I do need to turn this toward me. I used the Posterman paint pen. I like this because it allows me to get some heavier lines, although if I use the point of the chisel and I turn it this way, then it means that I can get skinnier lines too. But it does allow me a lot of flexibility here to do various things, and I can continue this design down if I want. And in fact, if I decide that I want to close her head in a little bit, and if I want to give her a crown, I can certainly do that, and I can come back and do it a little bit sketchier if I want. Lots of different ways that you can do this. And, well, that wasn't very good. I just smudged that with my finger. But nevertheless. So, here's the thing. In all of the colorways in the dilutions, or excuse me, in all the color options in the dilutions and the color wash, there's nothing that resembles any kind of flesh, whether it's Caucasian, African American, Asian, there's nothing. So you have to find a way to do that yourself. And I want to show you how I do that. This is not what we need. Someplace here is a brand new brush. Here it is. All right, so let me bring this in. This is just one of Tim's water brushes. Take this little black tip out. This is what controls the flow of water in there. Whoops, in there. Let's see. See that little nib right there? That goes down inside here. That allows the flow of water to the head. So, let's see. The easiest way that I've found to make something that resembles flesh, again, of any ethnicity, is to start with something brown. Now, I tried this with ground coffee, and I didn't like the color quite as well, so I use, this is the Dilutions Melted Chocolate. Again, you can see it's the full-strength version, and you're going to be amazed at how little of this takes. All I'm going to do is touch the inside here a little bit, just to get some color in there, and then I'm just going to spray this in here. All right, and as this color begins to mix with the water, it lightens considerably. Now, you could use it this way. Let's just see what this looks like. Or you can change it. It's really up to you. But what you have to do is you have to test it just a little bit to see how it looks. And you can alter the overall tone by adding a little bit of some sort of a pink or a red, and I'm talking a minute amount, or by adding a little bit of yellow to change the color to a little bit more yellow tinge, or you just simply make it darker for African American skin. So this is what I just made. Let's see what this looks like. This actually looks a little bit lighter than this one that I made yesterday. So let's just go ahead, and you have to squeeze this. Well, that might have been a little bit too much, but you can see, there we go. You can see the color as it comes out. Now this is really, really pale. And you might think that that's a problem, but I don't. I have 3 water brushes now with 3 different variations, from light to medium to dark. So I'm working on watercolor paper. It's pretty much the standard of what I work on. And what I have found is that any kind of watercolor paper, if you repeatedly scrub over it like this to lay down multiple coats or whatever, you get the color you want, but you're also going to start pilling it. There's just really no way around that. So you can start with a lighter color like this and then just go ahead and lay, well, there's pilled paper. You lay down a base coat of color. And all I'm going to do is just lay this down. Now, because I want to blend what's on here with what I'm going to add to it, I don't mind coming back and working on this while it's wet. I'm just going to pick up my darker color. See how that looks? That's a little bit dark. So let me just come in and I'm going to lay down a little bit more color. Now, think about where shadows would ordinarily fall. And actually, some of this is already outlined for you. You can see shadows here on the neck. You can see a little bit of shadows under the hairline. That's the place where shadows are naturally going to fall. So you can just come and lay some color in and kind of emphasize that. It'd help if I had actually done her neck. Okay. So let me come back, and again, I'm going to put a little bit of shadow here. The shadow on the side of her neck, and it would be under her chin, because her chin is actually going to throw a shadow underneath on her neck. And it's really that simple. The other thing that I like to do is I like to keep one water brush with just water in it, and I like to do various things with it. The first thing that I like to do, let me find the right color. I typically use cranberry for the cheeks. That's not cranberry. That's not cranberry. Where is it? I know it's here. I had it. There it is. So what I would do, and I'm just going to do this in front here, put a little bit of cranberry out on my craft sheet. I'm going to make certain that I have moisture in the brush, and then I'm just going to pick up the littlest bit of this color and I'm going to pull it away so I only have a tiny bit of color on there. Now this is dry and that's fine. I don't want the color to wick out beyond her cheeks, so I'm just going to lightly touch a little bit of color in here. If I think that's too much, I can come and wipe the color out of the brush and just come back with some water and touch it in place like that. Pick up the rest of this and add a little bit of pink to her cheek here. And then I can add just a little bit. Her lips are not terribly open here, but I can add a little bit that suggests some color on her lips. Then you can start playing, and let's move over here. Let's move to this. Then I'm not going to actually go ahead and work on her dress all that much beyond what's here, because you get the point. So let's just sort of start from scratch. I'm going to lay some of my lightest skin tone in here. And then I'm going to come in with a slightly darker shade. Oh, I forgot her neck again. I'm going to come in with a slightly darker shade. And I'm going to just put some shadowing in. Whoops. What am I doing here? Backwards. Now I can put some shadowing in. There we go. And a little bit here. Definitely some under here. And boom, she's a Caucasian colored person. Again, you change the color depending on what ethnicity you're trying to represent. So back to the cranberry that I mysteriously set down and have no clue where it is again. This is the one, I have no idea why, but this is the water brush with the color that I lose all of the time. I'm forever looking for cranberry. So again, I'm just going to touch this here. If I think I've got too much, and I'm just going to lay the tiniest bit of color in, and that's definitely too much. So I'm going to just put some water down in there. And I'm going to spread this out. Same thing over here. Get some more water on there so I don't overdo it to begin with. And just lay a little bit of color in there. Now, when you start talking about clothing, you can do almost anything. Again, I have all of these colors, and this is sort of my go-to thing. This is how I pretty much color everything, which is why I have so many colors here. So this is Stream. That's one of my favorite colors. Let's just come in and lay down some Stream on her upper bodice here. And then she's got this kind of thing going on around her neck. So I think I'll lay some Stream in there. And you notice I'm not filling this in all the way. Again, I'm trying to sort of keep up with that very loose, open look that Dina started. And maybe I'll just take, this is Polished Jade. Maybe I'll just take a little bit of Polished Jade and darken the neckline of this a little bit. So you see, there's just a multitude of ways that you can work with these. And then you just cut these out. You can add them to your journal pages. You can add them to all of your projects. I mean, they're real easy to do, and they're incredibly effective. The last thing I want to show you today is just a little bit of a takeoff on the coloring that I did just a moment ago, and it's going to involve bringing in just a subtle hint of glimmer because it makes me happy. So I've got three colors of the F&W inks, and I'm just going to give them a shake, and all I'm going to do, now I'm going to use my water brush that has just plain water in it, all I'm going to do is put a little bit of each of the colors, well, that's a blocked eyedropper, but that's enough for me to do what I need to. I'm just going to put a little bit of each of these colors out on here so I have them to work with. And I'm just going to add the tiniest bit of shimmer to these. This girl is from Faces in the Crowd. These two are from Scribbly Woman. They are so wonderful. I mean, Dina's just done a wonderful job of creating these and letting us all play with her designs. So, got my water brush. It's got some water coming out of it. I'm just going to pick up a little bit of this and I'm going to stroke it on. Now this is going to be very, very subtle. And that's good. If you want really subtle, if you want to go a little bit more, you can certainly do that. You can kind of go over the top of it. It's really up to you. Same kind of thing here. I'm just going to stroke some of this shimmery stuff on here. I mean, this is a really nice way to use the F&W inks. They're out on my work table pretty much all the time, so I pretty much want to reach for them all the time. And then I think I'm going to use just a little bit to make this heart shimmer. I think that makes it look really nice. Kind of the same thing. Now I just need to clean the color. You can see that I'm just wiping the color out of my brush till the water runs clear. And I can pick up some of the pink and I can kind of stroke this in here if I want. Again, just adding a little bit of shimmer. Just brightens it up a little bit and, you know, kicks the intensity of the color and the shimmer up just a little bit. I can do the same thing here with her heart. Just kind of go ahead and fill that in. And then if I want to just clean this out again, I can come and pick up some of the Genesis Green and I can add it around this little ruffle around her neck, which is really cool. So there you go. I mean, the initial release of Dina's stamps and stencils and paints from Ranger are just a wonderful success. They are easy to use, the designs are terrific, they're really high quality, and I know you're going to have fun with them.